Hi, I'm Robert, and welcome back to the High Desert Ranch and Homestead. Today we're going to do a little bit of prep work for the cutting our hay field. And so that requires getting things ready, such as the baler and swather. So come along, come along with me and escape the ordinary as we enjoy life here in the Intermountain West. And I show you just what it's like to do a little work here on the ranch. But before we get to that, I just wanted to show you what it is we're going to be doing. So the hay is getting long. It's been super dry. In fact, we're in extreme drought, but as you can see, the grass is growing nicely, and we're probably not gonna get two cuts this year. We'll get this one cut, so we've let it grow just a little bit, and It's time. We're here right at towards the tail end of June, and things are getting hot and dry. We've been lucky and fortunate to have a little bit of cool weather, but I've been working on the baler and the swather the other night, and so I'm back. It's been a busy day, and the weather's a little cool, so instead of waiting till it's a little bit later in the day, it's nice. As you can see, it's overcast at the moment, a little bit of sun. So let's go ahead and show you what it is we're up against, because it's not just about cutting, it's all about the preventative maintenance and making sure things are go, because when you got to cut, you've got to cut, and you've got to get it fast. You got to cut it, rake it up and bale it and get up off the field as quickly as possible. It's all about timing, and you don't want to be caught with a lot of downtime repairs while your hay is sitting there out on the field, either getting super dried out and sun bleached or even rained on, which we haven't had to worry about that too much, but you just never know around these parts with Mother Nature. So let's go and check out the equipment. I don't know if you can see that little guy making all sorts of noise, a little rock chuck. So there you go, nice little chirping action. All right, so anyways, got some older equipment, but you know, when you're on the ranch and the homestead, you got to make do. So right here we've got a new Holland 499, a swather, cutter, whatever you want to call it. That's been all greased up. I've got to do a little bit more cleaning here off the back end, as you can see. Other than that, she's good to go. She's done us well here for the last little while. But now I'm over here working on the baler, because once it gets cut, we're going to be getting things baled and excuse me, very complicated machine, as you can see, and it's got quite a few of these Zerk fittings. I'll get in on that right there. Whereas the swather, the cutter, whatever you want to call it, it only has about 7 or 8, whereas this one has dozens of these just Zerk fittings, and it's important to grease it up, otherwise you'll have massive mechanical failure and parts will seize up when you're out there in the field, and then again you have costly downtime repairing parts. So we're also going to do a little bit of hydraulic oil refill. I checked it up here in the top and we'll be good to go. All right, so I'm just going to show just some of you city folk that don't get to see us every single day. This is what you call a grease gun. It's got this fitting right here that you just hook on the end of those Zerks that I was showing you. And depending on the fitting, sometimes you don't even give this much of a squeeze at all. And other times you give it a couple squeezes, depending on just how large the container is for that. So I'm going to do a little sped up, not real time, but sped up time as far as these Zerk fittings, just so you get an idea. Alright, so for those of you who haven't been up close to a baler before, they're actually very complicated machines. Pretty impressive as far as the engineering that goes into this. That's where basically the hay or the straw, alfalfa, grass, whatever it is you might be cutting, goes in. And through these spring tensioners, that's what controls just the amount of hay that goes into each one of these bales. So as it gets sucked up in these forks, these tines, they scoop it into there. And then here on this back side, you have these massive forks that rotate back and forth up through here, and they just spin down and they toss in all the hay into this baler section right over here. And it just simply compacts it in. And then this machine right here, these components, they pull the baling twine from this compartment that's then fed in mechanically into these points, and then it's just slowly just compacted together. And you can adjust your different sizes of bales as far as weight and whatnot. And then this spindle just slowly just spins the bales, and it just spits them out, as you can see, out to this point. And then it's cut off and then pushed out and dropped out into the field. So pretty cool. Some don't like to keep bales inside in the machine over the winter time. They just kind of happen that way. But I found it actually helps to kind of keep things tight, so you don't have to do so much tensioning the next year for your next season. And so and then this is just a pretty basic too right there. It just, these things, this arm actually drops down, and then these tines right here, they help to feed. And then down into here is actually where, I don't know if you can see that very well, these tines and these teeth actually move back and forth, and that's what cuts the hay, and then it gets spit out on the back side of the machine. So anyways, it looks like things are pretty good. I'm not seeing a lot of major mechanical issues, and sometimes you just got to get out there with the piece of equipment and start running it, and then you generally start getting into some some particular issues. So anyways, that being said, that's kind of the prep work that and some of the maintenance that goes into these machines. Hopefully sometime next week I'll be able to. And this is the rake. So when you finish cutting your hay, you run this along, depending on what you want to do, your setup, your operation, how much yield you're getting from your field. But this can just help to rake them up into bigger, thicker windrows, so you don't need to make as many passes with the tractor, which all adds up to savings with fuel costs and time, and makes you a little bit more profitable, or if you're trying to keep your costs down, if you're not going to sell your hay and you're just simply feeding what it is you grow and harvest. So not your average yard rake, as you can see. This one's a 20-foot rake, and very handy. It was handy last year when we tried to get our second cut and things were very thin. Like I say, it just makes it so you don't have to run around so much, especially as you can see when you're dealing with hay fields this size. It's all about being as most efficient as possible. We'll be able to get this all cut up and some hay baled, because like I say, with this major drought happening out here in the west, hay prices have basically doubled in price. So a lot of ranchers and farmers are being forced to downsize their herds because they won't be able to afford to feed them through the winter time. And we're pretty fortunate, we're not overextended, just a few cattle at the moment, with plans to expand next year. That's something my grandfather, he never wanted to overextend himself, and he wanted to be as self-sufficient as possible when it came to not only being in debt when it came to owning the land, but even being able to supply hay for his cattle. Rarely did he ever have to buy. So we'll be fortunate this year. We won't have to be buying. We'll be able to produce all of our own. As you can see, we've got this 40-acre hay field. And then on another video, I will show you just how to get a good measure, a good feel for how much you'll be able to produce in your field. So stay tuned for that, that fun little ranch tip, and some fun, easy calculations that you can do regardless of the size of your field. So that's it, gang. Thanks for coming along, and I'm glad that I was your ticket to help escape the ordinary here on the High Desert Ranch in Homestead.